So how was your sickness?
Really?
Oh, yeah.
That was a real challenge.
There were all these masks, AN95, which we couldn't fit to us. They were so faint, but you could still use them. We had to have when she's in this line. And then you fit it to a person's face. So the seats like the one million shades to be in that time that we got in.
Right.
That's great. Okay, you did that. See, two brothers, he's with all the women. So this is two chairs with just them. Oh, no, really. Dad's going to have this. Oh, my gosh, on his mother's side. And his mother's son, no. And his sister, one side, yeah. I'm so glad somebody could take that time.
The shower.
That's cool. It's going to be big to look at.
Good morning and welcome to this service of witness to the resurrection for our brother in Christ, family member and friend, John Logan Gregory. It's great. I'm grateful to see so many family members and so many folks joining us on YouTube. We are grateful for your presence this day. Hear these words from Scripture. When we were baptized into Christ, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might have new life. For if we have been united with Christ in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Let us pray together. Eternal God, maker of heaven and earth, you formed us from the dust of the earth, and by your breath you gave us life. We glorify you. Lord Jesus Christ, the resurrection and the life, you tasted death for all humanity, and by rising from the grave, you opened the way to eternal life. We praise you. Holy Spirit, author and giver of life, you are the comforter of all who mourn, our sure confidence and everlasting hope. We worship you, O Blessed Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, to you be the glory and the honor forever and ever. Amen. This morning, we will be sharing some passages that are meaningful to John and to the family, and some music as well that is meaningful to John and the family. First, I want to share with you familiar words, words that you know from the book of Psalms, Psalm number 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. We share these words because they are appropriate words on a day like today, that even in the valley of the shadow of death, the Lord is with us. In our moments of great joy, and even in our moments of great sadness and despair, the Lord is present. I love these words because these words also remind me of John, because in John's life, his cup runneth over. John was a blessed man, and in his being blessed, he blessed many others. So as we gather this day, we give thanks for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and we give thanks for John, for the example of his life and his lived out faith. Today, as much as we are sad, our cups runneth over in joy and thanksgiving for the love that John has for us and that we have for him. Before we share remembrances, I want to share one other psalm with you. It's a longer psalm, Psalm number 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good as long as you live, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works vindication and justice for all who are oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the people of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always accuse, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his steadfast love towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he removes our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear and honor him. For he knows how we were made. He remembers that we are dust. As for mortals, their days are like grass. They flourish like a flower of the field. For the wind passes over it, and it is gone, and its place knows it no more. But the steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear him, and his righteousness to children's children, to those who keep his covenant and remember to do his commandments. The Lord has established his throne in the heavens, and his kingdom rules over all. Bless the Lord, O you his angels, you mighty ones who do his bidding, obedient to his spoken word. Bless the Lord, all his hosts, his ministers that do his will. Bless the Lord, all his works in all places of his dominion. Bless the Lord. O my soul. And now we will listen to one of John's favorite hymns, Amazing Grace. Since John's passing, we've had many wonderful emails, cards, and letters come in, remembering John, telling stories and snippets along the way of John's life and their individual interactions with him, and wonderful stories. And so we're going to take a time to remember John and share these remembrances. The first person I'd like to call to come up is John, and then John will be followed by Matt and Dave.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
It may be that Dad was a typical 1960s man. He was all about church, family, work, and community. He was very dedicated to the Church of the Covenant. He was a member for I can't imagine how many years. He saw seven or eight pastors come and go and rarely missed a Sunday. When he couldn't drive anymore, he'd take the Spring Hill bus to church. And he was on the session and was a deacon and was probably on every committee the church had. He loved church music and hymns and sang in the choir for many years. Even when he was quite old, he helped distribute meals from the church kitchen. He also donated generously, so clearly his church was very important to him. And his family was very important to him. I once heard someone say that when you get married and start having children, your life becomes raising kids and paying bills. And with five kids, there was a lot of both. I often saw Dad in the office sitting at his desk writing checks and balancing the checkbook, money coming in and money going out. And tax time was always a challenge. It almost seemed like there was smoke coming out of the office when he'd sit down to fill out the 1040 form. Dad supported us with more than just money, though. He went to all our high school graduations and some of y'all's, too. He even came to my graduation from Spokane Falls Community College in 1993, flew all the way to Spokane, Washington, just to watch me graduate. That was a long way to go. And I suppose he went to swim meets and tennis matches and things like that as well. So Dad loved his family. Dad loved his job. He liked his job at Zurn, and he always said he liked the people he worked with. He often would come home for dinner and then go back to work at night. He traveled a lot, too. He went all over the United States and, I believe, to a foreign country once, maybe Japan or Taiwan. And once he came to Houston when I was still living there, we met at his hotel and went out for dinner. And after he retired, he would meet with the Zurn retirees once a month and would host them at Finley Lake for a summer picnic. Dad graduated from a very prestigious business school in Philadelphia, the Wharton School of Finance. And I once asked him why he didn't stay in Philadelphia and work for a great big company. And he answered, because I'm a small town guy and I just didn't want to live in a big city. So he came to Erie and worked for Zurn for 30 years. I think Dad also really liked Erie, this community. He was in the Junior Chamber of Commerce, the JCs. And after he retired, he delivered Meals on Wheels. And I actually went with him once on one of his meals runs, and we drove to a bunch of different residences on the east side. He'd say hello to the people and give them their meal. And I once asked him if he ever thought about going to Florida. And he said, no, all my friends are in Erie. My whole life is here, so I have no reason to go to Florida. So in summation, I'm glad I was able to spend the last couple of years with Dad. I'd come to Erie about every other weekend and take Dad for a drive around the peninsula. He said he loved the peninsula and looked forward to our drives. And during the lockdown, I would go to Erie every other weekend and go grocery shopping for him. I'd call him to get his list, and then I'd go to Wegmans on Peach Street and buy all his groceries for 2 weeks. And when the lockdown was lifted, we took a drive to Canadota Lake. And Canadota Lake is a man-made lake that's south of Erie, and it's surrounded by summer cottages. And Dad's father had built a summer cottage there. He bought that cottage through the Sears catalog and put the pieces together on a little lot he had there. And we didn't manage to find that cottage. It had changed somewhat over the years, of course, but it was still there. And that may have been the last drive we took together.
A few words about John Gregory. He always had a smile for everyone. He always had time to talk to anyone. He also had a mischievous side. He didn't like to mow the lawn. So one time as a small child, he set the lawn on fire. Then as years went by, he was in the Navy and he was given the job to set off to get rid of some old flares. And of course, as a young man, he set them off, which had some unfortunate results. He had many, many other stories, but one I can remember is when I was a small child, I would ask him about the fancy cars, you know, and things like that, the Lamborghinis and the Ferraris. And he once said to me, We could have had all those fancy things, but we had kids instead. Thank you.
Thank you, John and Matthew. I'm going to get him a cup of water, Chris. I'm going to do some readings for some people that cannot be with us, and then for some who are here with us but thought it might be too tough to get through. So those of you who were with us for John's 90th birthday party, you may remember a creative little acrostic that was put together, I think primarily by Donna Battersby, but she wanted us to share that again here today. And so it spells John Gregory, and I'll take each letter. J is for the jokes he used to tell during the break at choir rehearsals. O is for the other sailor he played in Gilbert and Sullivan's HMS Pinafore. H is for the help he gave me when Jean was ill. One of the things he did was to show his slides of his trips to us. Then when Jean was gone, he escorted me to Australia, Fiji, and Ireland. Always the perfect gentleman. N is for the neighbor he has been for some odd 40 years. G is for the gifts he has given to all the ladies at our Christmas dinner at the Adams. R is for the rigorous hikes he took with friends along the Appalachian trails, which lasted a week or more at a time. E is for the exceptional humor he displayed while he sings his many solos about the Sunday school pin and many others. G is for the generosity he bestows on others with money, handwritten thank yous, meals on wheels, and surprise birthday dinners. Oh, and don't forget all those daffodils he picked and took to the nursing homes. O is for the other home in the country, which he shared with many groups, like the college crowd, which held retreats over the weekends, and the retirees who held picnics every summer. R is for the religion he practices every day. Faith is a strong part of his day. And Y is for the family man he has always been. Oh, it doesn't begin with Y, but it ends in Y. So put it all together and you have John Gregory. And all of his friends took turns sharing those different letters, and it was a joyous time we had over at the Colony. Here is an email from John and Jean Wilkins. Fond memories of our dear friend, John. How are you, John? Almost perfect, he would reply. John was a proud father and grandfather. He loved his family dearly. He was quite the entertainer. In the old days, he served one of his soup concoctions in elegant china with a favor for each of us. As a proper guest, he always came to the party with a box of chocolates or a bottle of wine. As a joyful giver, he generously shared his garden crops with the community. Upon coming home, we would find his veggies at our door. As a faithful member of the Meals on Wheels for many years, he and John drove the weekly route, arriving at our home for a gossip session over a cup of coffee topped with sugar and cream. Another passion of his was to treat us to day trips, often to Canada, or around the hills of PA and New York. His country place was a favorite spot for him to entertain his family and friends. We remember many happy times there. We shall miss him and remember him with loving thoughts. John and Jean Wilkins. John and Jean and Donna, if you're with us, we thank you for those remembrances. My youngest son, Caleb. I always appreciated how Pop-Pop shared his love of adventure and traveling with us. He would travel around the country and internationally, take photos, then have us all sit down and watch a slideshow of all the places he visited. He definitely inspired me to go experience the world for myself, for which I will always be grateful. K. Caleb Schilling Smith. From his grandson, Logan. On the day of my wedding, Pop-Pop walked up to Annie and I at our table, and he shared a story with us. When he was a younger man with a young family, he was busy at work and busy with other obligations in the church and the community. He came home one day to find Susan upset about something. When he asked why, she replied that he wouldn't understand because he was never home. He was deeply moved, and he realized how he really wasn't around as much as he should be. From that time on, he made an effort to spend time with his family, and he shared with us that his biggest regret in life was not spending more time with his family when he had the chance. He told us never to let that happen to us, and I told him that it never would. Pop-Pop was always there for me with a wise word, and I will miss his guidance in my life. Thank you, Logan. From Carson Gregory Smith, in remembrance of John L. Gregory. In a short but meaningful manner, I would like to pay tribute to my grandfather, who I endearingly called Pop-Pop. As the oldest grandchild, I have many memories of Pop-Pop, too many to say here, but these are a few that I will always cherish. My family and I would travel up to Erie every summer when I was growing up, and as a boy, I remember it being quite a journey. Time stretches on longer when you are young and bored in a car. So that was the last thing I wanted to do when I got up to Erie, sit in a car and drive around delivering meals on wheels with my grandfather. It seemed lame and a waste of my vacation time. As an adult, I now understand the selfless act of helping to feed others and how important a role that is within a community. This was an act of kindness that Pop-Pop volunteered for, and I am thankful to have ridden along with him on his mission. Pop-Pop's cottages were a really special place. Driving to a somewhat remote location, surrounded by dense forest and a rather large pond, just invited adventure. I could run in the woods, swim and fish in the pond, and explore the buildings on the property, which teemed with old artifacts. I would see Pop-Pop smiling as he saw us run around. I know he was happy that this often empty property could be used once in a while. My earliest and final memory I would like to share is split into two parts. These two parts form a beginning that will never be forgotten. Arriving in Erie at a gigantic blue house on Delaware Avenue and being greeted by an equally big man and his dog, Alex. The man gave me a big bear hug as I stepped into the house, and that is when I met my grandfather, John L. Gregory. Photographs decorated the walls and tables of the house, little rectangular paper framed to capture happy memories from the past. I've never witnessed such kindness and love radiating from a photograph as the one of Nancy Gregory holding me when I was 1 year old. So much so that even though I have no memory of her, no physical memory, I can feel the love imparted to me from her as she held me. I see that same love reflected in my own mom when she holds her grandchild. Excuse me. It brings me such joy to know that Pop-Pop lived so long as to see his great-grandchild, and even though I'll miss him, I do have hope to see him again. I'm going to finish with Susan's. So it's about 4 minutes and 45 seconds long. It's very touching. I will do my best. As I sat with my dad at his bedside, some thoughts came to mind. John Logan Gregory was my daddy. Holding his 95-year-old hand in the nursing home, I was a little girl again, holding my big daddy's hand when he crossed the street. He was bringing me sick presents when I was sick in bed and needed cheering up. He was swinging me up on his shoulders and carrying me way up high. He was a hard worker. He wore a suit, and every day he worked with dry, clean collared shirts. I stood by his side at the bank when we were in line with other parents and their kids to deposit a check from a hard week of work used to support his big family. He sat on his favorite chair in the living room with papers spread all around, trying to finish work with five kids running everywhere. He traveled to many states and other countries for work and was away for days sometimes. I missed him, and I'd ask her mom, When will Daddy be home? He loved movies. He took me to see Dirty Harry, animated Disney, action and space movies with my brothers, probably because my mom just needed a break from everyone. He loved to eat. When he was younger, he could eat anything and stay thin. In retirement, the thin part changed. But that didn't stop him from eating bacon and chocolate almost every day. He served on the dining committee at Spring Hill, probably partly to make sure they served a good ham loaf and plenty of desserts. He was a man who loved life and his friends and family. We traveled by planes, a rented camper, the family station wagon to many destinations I'll never forget. He hiked and camped, took us sledding and rode the toboggan down Frontier Hill. He planted flowers and vegetables. He mowed the grass, used a chainsaw, shoveled snow. He read books, cross-country skied, played tennis, golf, rode a bike when he turned 80. He loved fancy parties with his friends and had glassware for every drink you could imagine. Using blenders and making crushed ice, he loved music and dancing. He took photos and home movies of everything. He would set up the screen and the projector so we could watch them and remember our family times together laughing and talking. He was a Christian. He took me to Sunday school and church. He had a servant's heart and joined community organizations in Erie that helped people. He served on committees at church and was an elder and a deacon. He sang in the choir for years. He prayed for his family. I heard him praying at night, and he prayed at meals. He went to Bible studies in church every Sunday unless he was sick or traveling. He was firm in his Christian faith. My father loved me and never gave up on me, though I was a very difficult daughter who challenged his way of looking at the world. We didn't always agree, but we loved each other. I'm thankful for my father, and I miss him terribly. My father, who has known me my whole life, is gone from this world. I won't hear him say, "Hi, Tweetsy Tootsy," again in his life, but I can hear him in my memories. I watched him as he experienced the challenges of aging, stiffness and problems walking, fatigue, painful joints, cancer, illnesses, hearing loss, the emotional sadness and grief he had as my mom and his friends died over the years. He was not a complainer, but his life was getting difficult. The separation from friends and family brought on by the coronavirus crisis was also very hard on him, as he was a very social person. When his heart began failing in June, his old body was at last wearing out, though I didn't want to accept it. His caregivers and others at Forest View the last few months had to be our hands and feet, our arms, and our voices of caring and encouragement daily to him and to other residents at Forest View. I thank them. People from food service to administration told me what a kind and thoughtful man he was and expressed their condolences. Near the end of his life, he questioned his value. I told him, "Dad, you can always thank and encourage people. Everyone needs to hear positive words, no matter where we are." I would say, by what people told me, that he was a positive, encouraging, and thankful person to the end. I am comforted by the fact that he has been freed from his bodily pain and suffering. I know that he is singing and dancing in heaven, where he is seeing Jesus face to face. Praise God, my daddy is truly home at last. Thank you, Susan Gregory Smith.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you.
I got it. You got it?
Yep. I'll just set it over here.
Thank you, John, Matt, and Dave, for sharing not only your own remembrances, but remembrances from others who aren't even with us present today, but hopefully are joining us on YouTube. I want to share a couple passages with you that were selected by the family for me to share and reflect on scripture, and also to reflect on John's life in light of scripture, in light of his faith in Jesus Christ. So our first passage we want to share is from the Gospel of John, John chapter 14, verses 1 through 6. "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go and prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again, and I will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going. How could we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And our last passage from Paul's letter to the Romans, Romans chapter 6, verses 3 through 9. Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body of sin might be destroyed and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. Well, I want to share simply some reflections with you, some meditations on these words and these words in light of John's life. I met John, actually, well, my first encounter with John was through a card. I arrived May 1st of 2017, and I received a lovely card, and it was a Christmas card. And in this card was a letter and a note that said, well, welcome to Erie, Pennsylvania. And this was right after the Christmas day in which we received 3.5 feet of snow. And John said, well, he's like, call this your baptism by fire. And when I got that card, I'm like, this is a guy I've got to meet. Because anyone who would send that is somebody who I appreciate their sense of humor and I want to spend some time with. We gather today to remember and to give thanks for John's life. We're gathered here with family, and we're gathered with many others who are joining us online, and we are grateful for everyone's presence. We gather here today because John is no longer physically present with us. Death is really not a mystery. In some ways, we know it all too well. In some way, the body ceases to function, systems fail, and life as we know it here comes to an end. The mystery really comes with the next step. What happens when we die, right? How many times have we heard this question? We ask it as adults, and even our children ask it. What happens when we die? Where do we go? What's heaven like? What is heaven like? What does it look like up there? The Bible actually says remarkably little. The Apostle Paul gives us some clues, though. Paul writes in Corinthians, listen, I tell you a mystery. We'll all be changed. Paul drops some hints here and there, but we never get a full picture. This perishable body, he says, must put on imperishability. This mortal body must put on immortality. Scripture doesn't tell us what it will look like, but it does reveal what it means. It does reveal what it means. Paul said, as we read in our passage and had in our opening scripture reading, don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Jesus's death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of God the Father, we might walk in newness of life. When we think of baptism, we tend to think of cute babies, at least in the Presbyterian Church. Little babies dressed in white, perhaps a baptismal gown that's been passed down through the generations. We think of little ones dressed in beautiful clothing, sprinkled with water, doing their best to cry or scream or kick to embarrass the minister. While the questions are being asked, cute babies making faces as they're sprinkled with too cold water, and smiling and cooing as we walk them down the center aisle so everyone can see their beautiful faces. We never say that this little one was baptized into Christ's death. Doesn't make for good press on a beautiful Sunday with cute little babies. Sort of steals the joy out of baptism, though actually it should do quite the opposite. If I could summarize what Paul is saying in these brief few verses in Romans 6, I would summarize it as this. Jesus blazes the trail and we follow. Jesus blazes the trail and we follow. I think it's pretty much as simple as that. In the same way that Jesus was baptized and began his ministry, we do the same, whether we're young or old. Just as Jesus was identified as the Son of God in his own baptism, we are identified as being children of the covenant, whether we're baptized at a few weeks or even as adults. Because Jesus was raised from the dead, we can walk in newness of life. If we've been united with him in a death like his, certainly we will be united with him in a resurrection like his. If we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. Where Jesus goes, we go. It's easy to write down things on a timeline. Every obituary is kind of the same. Where they were born, where we went to school, who we married, what we did, how many children we had, grandchildren, and there's nothing wrong with that. That's what belongs in the newspaper. It's easy to write down a chronological list of anybody's life. Certainly, John did many wonderful things in his life. He served in the Navy, graduated from Penn, the Wharton School, very prestigious school, as was mentioned a few moments ago. John married the love of his life. Sort of a fairy tale story, married the love of his life. He worked at Hammermill, at Shenango, China, 40 years at Zurn, did almost everything in the church that was imaginable, except probably preach. John and Nancy had five wonderful children, many grandchildren and great-grandchildren. It's easy to list those things, enumerate them, put them in a list with bullet points next to them. But life really isn't given meaning by accomplishments. It's given meaning by relationships. And that's exactly what we heard today. It's given meaning by relationships. And from what I can tell, John was pretty darn good at relationships. It's exactly what we heard just a few moments ago from Matt, John, and Dave. It wasn't accomplishments. Yeah, he worked here. He enjoyed his work. He didn't like paying taxes. Who does? But what we heard was stories about relationships and how he touched your lives, not just of friends, but of family as well. We're grateful for all those who are joining us, family here, friends, other relatives online. You know and you love John because of his kindness, his generosity, his sense of humor, his way about him. It's because of relationships, whether relationships from school, from work, biological relationships, relationships from church, relationships with neighbors. Life is really about our relating to one another, not what we can accomplish and put on a resume. Though John could fill out a nice resume, obviously. Faith was integral to the life of John Logan Gregory. Faith is not exactly about believing all the right things, though that's what some people would want to have us believe. It's important to believe the right things, but ultimately faith is about a relationship with Jesus, as it talks about in the Gospel of John. That relationship that John had with the church, that John had with Jesus, shaped his life in a profound way. Was John perfect? No. Well, almost perfect, maybe, to use his own words, depending upon who you talk to. But his faith shaped him in a very real way. So much so that faith being exercised, you know, as lame as it sounds, on your vacation going and serving Meals on Wheels, that's faith being exercised and lived out in a very real way. And sometimes we don't get it right away, but obviously, as time goes by, we start to understand these things. Where Jesus has gone, John has followed. Because he lives, John lives. Because he's been raised, John will be raised like him. That is true not just for John, but for every Christian. Jesus blazed the trail so that, just as we read from the Gospel of John, so that where I am, there you may be also. That's the great hope of the faith, that where Jesus is, we will be also, and that we as well will join those who have gone before us. Today, I want you to think about a couple things. How has John blazed the trail for you in a very meaningful way? We talked about how Jesus leads the way for us in faith, that we're baptized just as Jesus was baptized, that we'll be raised just as Jesus was raised, that we will walk in newness of life. How has John blazed the trail for you, giving you example of what it means to live a fruitful and meaningful life? It's not about the automobiles you could have had. That's exactly what he was saying when he said that. He would never trade his family for a car. If there's one thing I know about John from sitting with him so many times at home up on the hill there, was that he loved his family. It was so obvious. We'd have lunch together I call it the home. It's not a home, but you know what I'm talking about. We'd have lunch together there and we'd talk about things. He worked at Shenango, China. I served a church in Newcastle. I knew a lot about Shenango, China, and we'd share some stories in that way. I love what was read by Dave from John and Gene Wilkins. A proper guest, a joyful giver, a faithful member. Great descriptions. How has John sort of blazed the trail for you? About that card that he sent me in the winter of 2017, that was the first of many cards we would get at Christmas. And they weren't just cards, they were these pop-up cards. Do you know what I'm talking about? I don't know what they're called, but you'd open it up. It was always a thick envelope, and you'd open it up. And one year, it was a fire station with a Christmas scene. And then 2018, it was an airplane with Santa in the plane carrying presents. And then another one, it was a home. I have a whole village of cards sent by him. And every year we'd get these cards. And I knew it was from John because his handwriting was kind of hard to read. And I sort of figured out, John Gregory, I know who this is. So, and we'd put them up in the church on the filing cabinets in the office. And that's how we got to know John. Every year around between Thanksgiving and Christmas, this card would show up in the office and we'd pop it open. It's like, what did we get this year? And it was a new scene. And so that's what John was like. John was really good at relationships. And John wasn't perfect, though almost perfect, as we've said. Proper guest, a joyful giver, a faithful member, and I would say a wonderful friend. I got to be friends with John in my visits and enjoyed being with him. He was just a good storyteller. He was just fun to talk to. He was easy to talk to. And that's not always easy for someone who's in their 90s. He was hard of hearing sometimes, so he had to turn up the volume sometimes. But we had wonderful visits together, just talking about life, talking about you, to believe it or not, and all the wonderful things, the traveling and the hiking and the campers and things that went on vacations, about his property. He was so thoughtful towards others. So thoughtful towards others. I wish I could have John right here, right now. Because I'd say, John, how are you doing? I'd say, almost perfect. Well, you know what? Today, John is perfect. Today, John is made perfect because he's in the presence of his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Because this mortal body has put on immortality. His corrupt body has put on incorruption. I love the question that Thomas asked Jesus at the end of our passage. Jesus, how are we going to know the way where you're going? He says, you know the way, Thomas. I'm the way. Just follow me. I am blazing the trail for you. As we wrap up our time together, as much as it's a heavy day and it's a sad day, and as I hear remembrances being read, I hear the sniffing out here amongst you, and it's a heavy and a sad day. But in many ways, it's a joyful day. John has completed his baptism, as we like to say. Baptism is a one-time thing, right? You sprinkle the baby or dunk the adult. But really, baptism is a lifelong process of being transformed, of following Jesus down the path of faith. And so how are we going to follow not just Jesus down the path of faith? How are we going to follow John in this wonderful life that he's given us, this wonderful example of what it means to be someone who's in relationship with Jesus and in relationship with family, with friends, with neighbor? How are you, John? I've been made perfect. Amen. We're going to enjoy a second hymn, Be Thou My Vision, favorite hymn of John and the family.
Treasure thou art.
I'm going to pray, and then at the end of our prayer, will you join with me in the Lord's Prayer? I realize everyone comes from somewhat of a different tradition, so if you're a debtor, a trespasser, or a sinner, it really doesn't matter. You can be any one of the three that you would like. So let us pray together. Lord Jesus Christ, we give you thanks and praise for the life of John Logan Gregory, for the example of his life, for his walk of faith, for his sense of humor, all the gifts of the Spirit which you gave him, which he lived out so faithfully. Lord, we will miss him, but we are grateful that he is taken into your presence and that he is now made new, that he is indeed made perfect. Lord, until that time in which we are joined together again with him, bring us comfort by the power of your Holy Spirit. O Lord, with the saints, give rest to the soul of your servant John, where there is no sickness, nor sorrow, nor sighing, but life everlasting, memory eternal. Amen. Now let us join our voices together in the prayer which Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now, family and friends, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. This concludes our service here at the funeral home. We are so grateful for those of you who could join us online. At this time, we'll wait for Nancy Dustis to come and to give us our direction. Yes.
We have a final song.
Oh, we do?
We have a final song.
Oh, great. We're going to have a final song.
Yes.
Thank you.